Welcome to part B of Unit 1. We're going to be looking at the body cavities. I am Anna Galletly, and I'm going to be giving you a slight tour of this. All right, looking at the body cavities, what we're going to do is we are going to divide them up into dorsal and ventral body cavities. So this is one of those places where we use dorsal and ventral instead of anterior or posterior. So you see right here, we've got the dorsal. So the dorsal body cavity has two sections, one, the cranial cavity, and two, the vertebral cavity. Notice that within the cranial, you are only going to have the brain, and within the vertebral, you're going to have the spinal cord. So if I'm describing these things, I would say the spinal cord is within the vertebral cavity, which is within the dorsal body cavity, or the brain is within the cranial cavity, which is within the dorsal body cavity. Okay, now let's look at the ventral body cavity. So I'm doing that one in red right here. So if you look over here, I have three major cavities. I have the thoracic cavity, and then I have the abdominal cavity, and I have the pelvic cavity. Now, the abdominal and pelvic cavities have imaginary lines dividing them. So sometimes they are called the abdominopelvic cavity, and they are merged. The thoracic cavity is nice because we have the diaphragm muscle that separates it from the abdominal cavity. So that completely separates it. It's a very nice boundary line. Again, the abdominal pelvic is an imaginary line. So I look at the right here, there's a bone called the bony feature called the anterior superior iliac spine. It is on the ilium of your pelvis. We'll talk more about that in a couple of weeks. So you're going to draw an imaginary line from here all the way over. All right. And the upper part is the abdominal cavity. The lower part is the pelvic cavity. Typically in the pelvic cavity, you are finding a little bit of your colon, rectum, the reproductive organs, bladder, that sort of thing. Some of your other intestines will dip down in there as well. The abdominal cavity, you're looking at liver, gallbladder, I'm going to abbreviate that, kidneys, the bulk of your intestines, all of that good stuff. Okay? Now we have other, let me back up a little bit. Let's change color again. We're going to go to green. I want to further subdivide the thoracic cavity. I have two pleural cavities here and here. All right. Then I have the mediastinum there. The mediastinum is technically divided up into superior, intermediate, and inferior. For the purposes of this class, just remember mediastinum. And then I have the pericardial cavity. I wonder if I can change colors to a purple. I don't see a purple, so I'm going to pick yellow. So within the mediastinum, I have the pericardial cavity. Okay? And the pericardial cavity is where you have your heart. So you may have heard of pericardium, pericardial. That's where your heart. The lungs are in the pleural cavities. In the mediastinum, I have the pericardial cavity with the heart in it. So you've got the heart. You've also got the esophagus. Part of the trachea is within the mediastinum. So when I'm talking about things, I would say something like the heart is in the pericardial cavity, which is in the mediastinum, which is within the thoracic cavity, which is within the ventral body cavity, okay? Now, these cavities, the dorsal and ventral, so those are the major body cavities where you've got really big organs in them, all right? We've got other body cavities. I've got them up here in orange. These are little ones. So like your mouth, the inside of your mouth is the oral. The inside of your nose is the nasal. The orbital is where your eye is. Okay. Middle ear is where your ear bones are. Synovial is going to be a joint cavity. So we've got other little cavities in the body, but the big major ones are the dorsal and ventral. And oh my gosh, I just noticed I left out a letter. So there should be an S in there. So that should actually read D-O-R-S-A-L. All right, next slide. All right, so now that we've got a basic idea of what our body cavities are and the abdominal pelvic cavities, let's talk about our tic-tac-toe board and our four quadrants. Now, depending on whether you're an anatomist or a medical practitioner or a surgeon, you're going to use a different system to kind of convey regions of the abdominal pelvic cavity. If you want to be really, really specific, they use what I call the tic-tac-toe board. Each one of these areas gets a name. The epigastric region. So epi means around, gastric is the stomach. So this is around the stomach. Umbilical. Well, this belly button thing, its real term, the real name for it is umbilicus or umbilicus. So that's around your belly button. Hypogastric. So hypo means below, gastric is stomach. So this is the area down there. All right, so then you've got the lumbar region here. Okay. Hypochondriac is there. And then you've got the inguinal region, that's your groin region. Okay, let's move on to the next slide. All right, for the purposes of this course, we tend to use the quadrant system more often. So that's just dividing it into four quadrants. You've got right upper, right lower, left lower. What's important about this is it helps you communicate things. So if I'm saying like, someone has a knife wedged into their upper right quadrant. Well, then you know it's not down here and it's probably not affecting their rectum. And instead, it is probably going to be affecting their liver. Okay. Or if they have ruptured their spleen, make an incision in the right lower quadrant, well, then you know you're about to do something wrong because the right lower quadrant is here and your spleen is over here. So using these quadrant terminology, it helps people talk about what they're looking at and directing other people to look at the same thing. So it's important for communication and to use the right terminology. All right, let's move on to the next slide. All right, so we're going to quickly talk about serous membranes because we are talking about the body cavities and it's going to be coming up. You're going to get more into this as you start doing histology. So this will seem a little, maybe a little overwhelming right now because we haven't talked about it too much. But you need a preview in order to move on. Okay, so serous membrane, also called serosa. All right, so you can call it serosa or serous membrane. What you want to know is that it's in the ventral body cavity and it is a thin double layer of tissue. All right, all membranes are going to consist of two things, an epithelium, which we're going to talk more about in the next lecture, and a layer of connective tissue, typically anterior, but sometimes a reticular. Okay, so you need to know that these are always sandwiched together when you've got a membrane, whether it's a serous membrane, a mucous membrane, or a cutaneous membrane. I'm going to be saying this a lot as we go over the next couple of weeks and we're talking about tissue types. So these membranes, they reflect or touch. So reflect is kind of another way of saying touch when you're talking about something. So if it reflects up onto the walls of the ventral body cavity, we call it parietal. So whenever you see this word parietal, think wall. Whereas whenever you see visceral, you're thinking of viscera, and you may have heard of that word before. So that's basically your guts. The viscera of an animal is the guts of an animal. So intestines, heart, liver, kidney. So the visceral serosa reflects up onto those organs or guts. Okay, in between the sandwich layer, this is really important, I have serous fluid. This fluid is secreted by the cells of the serous membrane. And what it does is it prevents sticking between the two layers. All right, so everything in the body is moving just a little bit. And if things can't slide against each other, they stick, you get inflammation, it's painful, it hurts, it's bad. So I want you to imagine a slip and slide. So I think most people have done a slip and slide. That's the piece of plastic you put on the ground and you put water on it and you run and you slide across it. Imagine trying to do that with no water, okay? That's what happens if you don't have serous fluid and it's bad, it hurts, okay? And we have different kinds of serosa. We change the name. depending on where it's located. Now let's look at that. Right, so now we're getting to the slide. The whole reason I went over what serosa was to be able to tell you this part. So around the lungs, right here, okay, here and here, the serosa, we give it the name pleura. All right, so the pleura goes around the lungs, okay? If it's going around the heart, we call it pericardium. Oops, wrong one. Pericardium. Now notice sometimes I use the word parietal, sometimes I use the word visceral, so I can call it parietal pericardium or visceral pericardium. And what that tells me is it close to the wall? Okay? Or is it touching the organ? Okay? And the same thing with pleura. I can have parietal pleura up against the wall, or I can have visceral pleura touching the lung. And then within the abdominal pelvic cavity, we call it peritoneum. Okay? And I can have parietal peritoneum or visceral peritoneum. All right, so that ends this particular video lecture. And in the next set, we will be talking about epithelial tissues.